Holy Spirit, you are welcome in this place. Hallelujah. That's a good song to sing. You're welcome in this place. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, thou art welcome. Haven't sung out in a while. In this place,
glory to God.
Omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, Holy Spirit, thou art welcome in this place. Hallelujah. It's welcome, Ethan. We always say, thou art welcome, thou art welcome in this place. Thou art welcome, thou art welcome in this place. Hallelujah. Omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, thou art welcome in this place. Good morning and happy Pentecost to everyone who is receiving this broadcast and on these different platforms this morning. Wow, we have reached the occasion of celebrating the appearance of Holy Spirit in the earth from the time of Easter, what some people call the Resurrection Sunday. Time of the resurrection to the time of the manifest presence of Holy Spirit in the earth, we can rejoice and say he came and he's been here ever since, glory to God, and we're able to celebrate his appearing in our lives and live with the knowledge of his presence and his work that is continual in our lives. He continues to work. Glory to God. God bless each of you that have joined us today on this great morning. Some folks have joined us from all parts of the earth in different countries, different regions of the United States. Some folks have already had their days of worship and others' time of worship throughout their day, especially those on the East Coast. I know God's blessed me. We have followers and partners and many of them are on the East Coast because that's where I've had been for so long. But for everyone that's with us and especially those that are part of this great ministry, Revival Power Ministries, here in this Los Angeles City region of Van Nuys, California, and under the leadership of these great people, these great Bishop Robert Kayungo and Pastor Barbara Kayungo and all the members of Revival Power Ministries, we are just excited, and I'm just kind of settling myself back down because I've been up, hyped up, if you will, as the young folks say, all week. Glory to God. I thought we were about to take off with Sister Brenda, but she, you know, it didn't work like that just then. But glory to God. But I'm gonna trust the Holy Spirit will make that transition when she comes in a few minutes anyway to take the time of worship over and just prepare the hearts of people for the morning message from Bishop Kayungo. I'm here to talk about leadership, teach on leadership, and we're really wrapping up, if you will. We've been going now since March, and because of the health situation, the pandemic situation in the earth, God led Bishop to move us this way, and we've continued this way. But my aim is to wind us, bring it all together as we talk about methods of leadership. And we started that last week. This is part two in dealing with methods of leadership. One of the things about the kingdom of God is God has a structure. God has a structure. He doesn't do things haphazardly. He always has a plan. And God's plan is so strategic. I mean, he's on point with everything that he wants done. And that's the key. It works for him. We live our lives in a way that we want what we want. We believe what we want. We have teachings on how to get what we believe we are supposed to have and what's available to us. We have scriptures like Psalm 37 where he says that the Lord will give you the desire of your heart. And, you know, so we move on. We have those kinds of scriptural references. So it's a matter of perspective. It's a matter of your perspective on your relationship with God, how you feel God is dealing with you or his purpose in your life. What is his purpose in your life? When you get that in line, when you get a revelation, a mindset of God's purpose in your life, then you can move forward, glory to God, with understanding how his structure works for you, how you fit into his structure. Glory to God. Hallelujah. It's not about how God fits into your life, and that's what most folks who have a relationship, who want to claim a relationship with God, they deal with it from the perspective of how they can fit God into their life. Well, the reality is how you fit into the plan of God, because God was here before all of us. He created all of us, and so we need to understand that he's got a plan and he's got a purpose for me in that plan. So that's what I live by. Lord, how do I fit into your plan? So in the whole scope of everything in dealing with leadership, well, we need to understand that not everything is the same. Not everybody leads the same. Not everybody walks things out the same. And so if you look at the Word of God, you begin, if you're talking about leadership, well, you can talk about poor leadership and talking about Adam's poor leadership with Eve and his assignment in the Garden of Eden. That's a different type of leadership. That's leadership in the home. He was just a poor leader, you know. But we move forward. Really what matters to the church, what we call the church, which, okay, let me throw this out there as a caveat to everything I'm going to talk about, is that what we have done in the church will never again be the same as what we used to do. What we have done, we will not do it the same way again. God has advanced this. There's nothing that ever happens on the earth like this. You can look through time and see these cataclysmic, if you will, these major occurrences, major things that have happened in the earth. There's always a shifting. There's always something that moves the kingdom into a different dimensional reality. And right now, today, I promise you, I'm telling you that we've stepped into another dimensional reality, because we're marking recognition, we're giving recognition to the power, presence and power of Holy Spirit. And I'm going to ask everybody and remind everybody, please mute your mic on your Zoom, glory to God, so that it's not heard. Hallelujah. So let's understand, okay, understand that there is a shifting. And so even as we talk about leadership styles, I promise you that the leadership style for every leader, glory to God, the mentality of leadership for every leader, everyone who's called to senior leadership, every pastor, every apostle, every bishop ought to be getting a sense of transition. We talked about transitioning in leadership, transition into the flow of what Holy Spirit wants to do now and going forward. Glory to God, because we're in a significant period. So there has to be something going forward. Hallelujah. But we want to look at, you know, what makes styles different. For example, let's look at, we're looking at the Mosaic style of leadership. We talked about that, you know, three basics, and then we're going to talk about a more intimate style of leadership. But Moses' style of leadership, David, the Davidic style of leadership, and the apostolic style of leadership, which the apostles began to implement after the ascension of Jesus back into heaven. Glory to God. But I want to conclude all of that with the intimacy that comes from Paul in dealing with people in a more personal relationship style. All right? So, but for the rest of today, glory to God, I want to do my best by the power and grace of the Holy Spirit to wrap up Moses' style of leadership. So from Exodus chapter 18, glory to God, where we were last week, we get a sense of Moses celebrating the victory that the people of God have come out of Egypt, and they are now in the wilderness on their way to the land of promise. You'll recognize that eventually they spent 40 years getting to the land of promise unnecessarily, but there were issues in there. Okay, there are issues in the reasons why they got there. Not because God couldn't get the people where he wanted them to go in the time frame that he had this designed for, but there were other things going on. So we know Jethro, we talked last week, Jethro brought Moses' wife and children to meet him in the wilderness. And so they spent a day of celebration, celebrating the victory, giving glory to God at bringing them through. And now they're at, glory to God, verse 13, where we're going to pick it up. We talked a little bit about that last week, but we're going to pick up there and move forward with this. Okay, so verse 13, Moses, Exodus 18, 13, it came to pass on the morrow that Moses sat to judge the people, and the people stood by Moses from morning unto the evening. Verse 14, and when Moses' father-in-law, this is Jethro, saw all that he did to the people, it's significant, again, we talked about this last week, that it's important for a leader to recognize that he's called, that what he does, his ministry's leadership style should be a blessing to the people, but it should be, he's doing it for God, for the people, for the benefit of the people. He's obeying God for the benefit of the people, not doing something to the people which represents or signifies that he was doing something that was not good for them. Glory to God. So we've got to understand this. No leadership style should be detrimental. It should always be positive. Hallelujah. Whether people understand that or not is not the issue. But if I'm obeying God, I have to trust that what God is saying to me is positive. Hallelujah. It's not detrimental. It's not going to tear the people around. Tear the people down and mess up things. Now, it may shake them up, which is okay. My leadership style or leadership style of a person called by God who has a relationship with God might shake things up. But then what that does is get people out of a comfort zone. Get them out of a place where they are so comfortable that they're complacent. Complacency is never good in the people who are following God, because change is something that's actively happening. Change is continual. God is always moving. Glory to God. And Holy Spirit, as we know now, as we represent and celebrate Pentecost, Holy Spirit is always up to something in our lives. He's urging us. He's dealing with us. He's speaking to us. He wants to speak through us. Glory to God. He's always speaking for us. So it's up to us to understand that the leadership style we deal with may unsettle us or make us uncomfortable, but it doesn't come to harm us. It always comes to bless us. Amen. And so Jethro looks at what Moses is doing, hallelujah, from morning unto the evening, hallelujah, and what he does to the people, and he deals with this, and he says, what you're doing is not good. He says, this thing is not good. Hallelujah. And Moses had a justification for it. Okay? It's important that we understand that when God is moving, we shouldn't justify getting stuck. Don't justify getting stuck in any one condition, because God doesn't stay there. When God dealt with Moses, he said one of the things when Moses, we see it in Moses going up into the mountain to get the laws of God, you know, get the tablet of God. He says, I want to know you. I want to see your face. And God says to him, he says, no man can see my face and live. He says, but I'll tell you what, if you stand in the cleft of the rock, I'll put you in the cleft of the rock, in this hidden place, in this structure that, you know, just will protect you. He said, you will see my backside as I go by. In other words, you'll see the trail of my presence. And so I'm moving, you know. Other scriptures let us know God is always moving. God is not stagnant. He does not get stuck. And that's what, even in our lives, we shouldn't get stuck. No matter how long it seems we have to wait. Hello, somebody. Watch me now. No matter how long it seems we have to wait, does not mean we're getting stuck. Glory to God. So there's a difference between waiting on God and getting stuck in one position. Getting stuck means you have no clue about what to do, where to go, you know, what your future is, what the plan of God is. That's not the same as waiting on God, because you know he has a plan for you. I know God has a plan for me, okay? I'm waiting on God's timing for some things here in this region, but I'm okay because I'm not stuck. Glory to God. I'm still hearing God. I'm still motivated to move in the presence of God, to stay in the presence of God, stay before God. Hallelujah. That's what this is about. Hallelujah. So you stay in a place where you can encounter God, interact with God, and represent God, but you don't get stuck in your own understanding or stuck in your own misunderstanding, your own reality that does not honor God. All right? And so Moses, glory to God, is stuck in this little bit of time. He's stuck thinking this is the way he's supposed to do it. Well, isn't it clear that if you're doing things this way in the wilderness, you're not really going to make much advancement. You're not really going to be moving, because you got to sit there. He's sitting there from morning until even, King James says, morning to evening, glory to God, dealing with issues in the people's lives. How are you going to move forward if every day you're sitting right here dealing with this kind of stuff in the middle of nowhere? Well, I call it nowhere, but it really wasn't nowhere. They knew where they were. They're just in the wilderness. They didn't have their own country. They weren't in the place of promise. They were sitting there, and Moses was dealing with issues of everyday life. Well, watch this. These issues were definitely transitional issues. They were not lifestyle issues because they weren't where they were supposed to be. A lot of times, leaders deal with things in our lives, and I'm dealing with this now. A lot of times, leaders will deal with, we want leaders to deal with things in our lives which slow them down because we're not where we're supposed to be. We're not in the place of God. We haven't grown. We haven't advanced in our relationship with God. And so as a leader, we call on our leaders to judge from morning to evening, basically, what he's doing. Lord, Bishop, can you help me with this? Pastor Bob, can you help me with this? I need to talk about this. Well, why are we talking about this when you should be way over here? Why are we still dealing? Okay, let me go there. I hear you, Holy Spirit. Why are we still dealing with the issue of tithing? If you're not a believer about tithing, are you sure you're supposed to be in this ministry? Now, I'm talking different than him. He's not going to say anything that's going to sound like, oh, no, he doesn't want you to go. I'm trying to get you to understand that you're in a place where we believe that tithing is of God, that giving is of God. So why is it you need reassurance about giving after you've been a part of this for months? Glory to God. That means you don't want to understand. You don't want to change. So you're stuck. You're stuck in an issue of how should I handle what you consider to be my money. See, my perspective on money is it's all God's. Everything that comes into my life is the Lord's. Glory to God. And I follow the pattern that he's given. Oh, can I help you people who say tithing is not of God or tithing is Old Testament? Let me tell you that the Bible says that Abram gave tithe of all before there was ever any law. Okay? When Abram gave tithe, there was no law, so tithing is not of the law. Okay? When Abram gave tithe, it was not about testaments. So there was an Old Testament knowledge. It encompasses the fact that Old Testament means the Word of God before Jesus came. Okay? So it's a fallacy to say tithing is Old Testament. No, Jesus said, when he dealt with the Pharisees, he said, you tithe. He said, but you tithe as a matter of being of trying to make people think you're doing something right. He said, but you ought to tithe. He said, this ought you have done. He said, but you still got to walk in love when you tithe. So in other words, Jesus still, he did not destroy tithing. He promoted tithing. So why am I saying that? Because people are stuck on issues. I just chose that issue. I heard the Holy Spirit tell me to deal with that issue. And that's not just the issue. It's an issue for a lot of people in the kingdom about their giving, about their relationship with God in terms of giving. Do you know that giving represents your heart? Your giving represents your heart. If you struggle to give, you're struggling with your relationship with God. God does not have all of you if you struggle to give him your tithe. Because the tithe represents the first. And every time you give God the first, it's throughout the Word of God. You cannot delete tithing from the principles of the Word of God. Every time you give God the first, prosperity follows. Multiplication follows. Increase follows. Glory to God. And so when you do that, you shouldn't be stuck in that in this time. So that's what I'm saying. Moses was dealing with issues where people were stuck. Well, the whole nation of Israel was stuck. Hallelujah. And his leadership was representing them being stuck instead of representing them moving. You know what I'm saying? So a leader cannot get stuck in what the people are dealing with. The leader has to move the people past being stuck. For example, I'm using Bishop because I'm here, but Bishop can't preach to you every Sunday about how to help you understand about tithing. He's got to expect you're going to get it. Otherwise, you're going to be in competition with God's moving in the earth in through this ministry. You're going to be walking in contrary to what God is saying. That's never good. Because that's disobedience, okay? Go somewhere if you want, okay? If you just don't believe in tithing, you need to go somewhere where they don't believe in tithing. Doesn't mean it's right whether they believe. If they don't believe it, if somebody else doesn't believe it, doesn't make it right. It's just you're in agreement with people who aren't right. That's big whether y'all get that or not, you know? Some people are in agreement with folks who aren't right. And they're more comfortable in a place where it's not right. But it's right to give. And so I don't want to stay on that too long, but I don't want you to get stuck. And you being stuck affects the movement of the leader. And so Moses was stuck. He's stuck dealing with people from morning to night, dealing with issues in a wilderness reality. Can you get a concept of that? They're dealing with issues because they're in a place they're not supposed to be. Wow.
He's dealing with stuff in people who should be making advancement. The people should have been so glad to get out of Egypt that they never want to get stuck. Moses, let's keep going. Let's keep going. Let's keep going. Glory to God. But Moses is dealing with stuff with people who they don't know how to live free. They don't know how to live free. They've been in bondage for all these years. Hallelujah. All the years. Boy, there's so much I can deal with about slavery issues. I don't want to deal with that right now. Too much is going on in the earth. Glory to God. Hallelujah. But Moses is ministering, leading people who've been in their condition, in their situation. They had their bloodlines like this, you know, and they're the first of their bloodline that they can remember. Are you hearing what I'm saying? They can remember. They know the history of their people. And I can talk about that a little bit as we go forward. These folks that he's dealing with know the history of their people was not always in bondage. But over the years of their lives, they were born into bondage. They've been living in bondage in Egypt, glory to God. Because most of them don't even know Joseph. They didn't know how they got there. Hallelujah. They didn't know Jacob. Glory to God. And so that being the reality, they are coming out of what they were born into. Man, I feel so much in that. They're coming out of, glory to God, a place of bondage into freedom, and they don't know how to handle their freedom. They don't know how to handle the fact that God has released them from the bondage of their enemy. Can I tell you, God has released you from the bondage of your enemy, but you got to get a revelation on how to handle that. That's why the bishop, that's why the pastor, that's why your leader teaches on how to handle your freedom in Christ. Most folks will teach, give you an understanding of your authority, your positional reality in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah. You've been saved, and now you're walking in the freedom of Christ. Glory to God, you got grace on your life, but that freedom now comes with responsibilities to the God who freed you. God gave you freedom. He gave you new life. If any man be in Christ, 2 Corinthians 5:17 through 21, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature, new creation, new entity. Hallelujah. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. Glory to God. Verse 21 says, and he made Jesus Christ to be sin, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. I am righteous in him. I'll never get any more righteous. There's nothing I can do to increase my righteousness. So he's released me into his righteousness. Now, what am I going to do with it? How do I walk it out? That's why God gives us leaders. That's why God puts people who have advanced themselves in their relationship with him, who are qualified to be able to teach something because they walked it out. You cannot teach what you don't know. You can't lead where you don't go. And so because we've gone somewhere, we've lived something, we have experienced something, we're able to share with others what we have lived, what we know. Hallelujah. I can only teach you what I know. Glory to God. And I'm still learning. I want to learn because there's so much more to know in the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And so I don't want to get stuck in what used to be, because what used to be no longer exists. What is God saying now? Where's God taking us now? That's where leadership comes in to get us where we have not been. Leaders take us where we have not been. Glory to God. They give us an unction. They urge us. They can't make us do it. That's where Holy Spirit comes in our lives, to move us along. Hallelujah. To help us make progression to places where we have not been. Moses was trying to get the people of God to a place where they had not been, but they were stuck. Okay? So he's dealing with these things and their issue. And so Jethro says, I'm going to tell you what I see. Hallelujah. And we'll see how this works. Glory to God. So in verse 18, he says, thou art going to really... Well, verse 17 says, and Moses' father-in-law said unto him, the thing that thou doest is not good. Thou wilt surely, there's no doubt about it, surely wear away. I've seen it happen, both thou and this people that is with thee. For this thing is too heavy for thee. Thou art not able to perform it thyself alone. Are you hearing me? Okay? That's big, okay? I've seen leaders do that. I've seen leaders so scared of giving somebody else another opportunity, so scared of delegating responsibility, that they try to do everything themselves, and I've literally seen men die early. I've seen it in my lifetime. I've seen men die in the pulpit and think that's, some people think that's glorious. I don't see anything glorious about that. I'm sorry, I just don't. I've seen men die, wear their bodies down. They may not have died while they're preaching, glory to God, but they died because they took too much of the responsibility on themselves. Well, you know, we're going to go into this some more in Ephesians, where why he gives us, you know, gifts in the body in Ephesians 4. I'll just say it like this. Ephesians 4, for those of you that are taking notes and referencing, he goes on to say that he gave us gifts the apostle, the prophet, the pastor, the teacher, the evangelist, for the edifying of the saints, for the building up of the body of Christ. He says, for the saints, if you read that after, the last thing says, for the saints to do the work of the ministry. My job, my assignment at this stage of my life, even in this place, is to speak a word to you, is give you instruction, share with you insight, revelate, get you so that you can get a revelation, information that leads to your a revelation, glory to God, and that revelation hopefully will give you an inspiration for a visitation, glory to God. That visitation will lead to a habitation, I'm talking, and that habitation then will create a manifestation in your life. That's where it starts. It starts with information, and you build from there, glory to God. My job is to inform you, to inspire you, to hopefully give you a revelation so that you can build on something and you do what God's called you to do. I've been doing for mostly all of my life. Glory to God. I said this a couple of weeks ago on the 14th. I entered into my 46th year of ministry. I've completed 45 years of public ministry. And not in the background ministry, public ministry. They didn't have me out front. I'm talking about preaching. I'm talking about doing the things in ministry. What have you done, Bishop? Well, Bishop, I swept the floor. You know, I'm talking to Sister Brenda. This is Brenda listening to me. I swept the floor, Sister Brenda. I played the keyboard, Sister Brenda. I played the guitar, the drum. Didn't do the drums as well as I played the guitar and the keyboard. I've done all that, glory to God. I stepped away from it for a season, for as long as I can. I don't care if I never go back to all that, because it takes away from what I'm doing here. Are you understanding? Take away from my time on my knees. I've mopped floors, buffed floors, put shine on floors, cut grass, painted buildings, cleaned bathrooms. Hello, somebody. I cleaned bathrooms. I pastored churches and had people walk in on me walk into the building because I was there already, and I'm cleaning the bathroom. Why you clean the bathroom, Bishop? Because it stunk. Hello? And it's not acceptable. It's not acceptable for people to come in to the house of God and there's a smell coming in there because you don't have enough air freshener to cover the stench, because brothers don't know how to do what they do straight. They don't clean up. It's nasty. Okay, these are realities. What do you say? Are you talking about all that stuff? Yes, I am, because it's realities that happen in the church. The church is not exempt from people not thinking. The church is not exempt from people needing leadership, needing help. They need somebody. But see, somebody has to do all that. Somebody has to have a heart to do all that. And if folks only show up just to come and praise, just to come and play the music, just to come and run the equipment, just to come and clap their hands and watch everybody else worship, then they're not really invested. It takes more than that. It takes somebody at the door, somebody at the gate in a building like this, somebody to make sure the gate is open, you know, for folks to come in and park under the building. And it takes folks who are aware that, you know, there are people out there. We used to have people, you know, we thought we could get away as our church grew. We had parking lot full. But all of a sudden, somebody's car got broken into outside our church. I was like, oh my God, I hadn't thought about needing security in the parking lot. Man. You know? We had a parking lot full of cars, and people started noticing, you know, because our church was growing. Man, every Sunday, we had our parking lot at the church, and then we had a parking lot across the street from the church that was full. We had cars parked along the sides of the street. You know, the place was packed. And so folks started noticing. They noticed. And so, you know, the devil notices. He notices what's going on in your life. He notices when you're making advancement. He notices when you're growing. And he looks for a way to infiltrate what you're doing, to try and slow you down, to try and mess up what's going on. And you've got to be discerning. You've got to be aware. Well, sometimes the awareness only comes after something happens. And you get into trouble. And you know, and it's just not pleasant. Well, it wasn't pleasant to have a couple people get their cars broken into. So from that point on, I said, okay, we got to bring the brothers together. I brought the brothers together and said, you know, hey, I need this person right here to be over security. Turned out one of my biological brothers is still in North Carolina. He became the men, glory to God, and we started delegating authority. That meant somebody had to go in the parking lot one Sunday. They couldn't be in there listening to me preach. They couldn't be in there clapping their hands and jumping up and down. They had to be willing to submit enough to go into the parking lot to handle things. Why? Because I could not preach, be in the parking lot, run the youth ministry, run the music, I couldn't do it all by myself. The ministry was growing. The ministry is too big. That's what leaders are for. Ministry to grow. If you don't have leaders, your ministry can't grow. If you don't get anything else, know that. And I'm going to tell you right now, I will not lead a small-minded ministry. I would expect. Now, I'm not saying this, and I'm not, you know, but I'm challenging you that are listening to me, because I know I've got some good people listening to me right now. I'm challenging you. I would tell Bishop, as a big brother, I would say to him, you need to get out of there. If you're doing it all yourself, listen, you got a family, you got a wife, you got children, you got folks who love you, but you're going to die trying to do it all yourself, and I would let that thing go. Because God is not in you dying doing what he called you to do. Jesus died. Hello, somebody. Jesus died, and because Jesus died, the rest of us don't have to die. The Bible says, you know, be thou faithful even unto death. Well, that's fine. But you don't have to die. The blood of Jesus was shed for all of us. All we have to do is use the principles that we taught in the Word of God and the weapons of our warfare, and we walk out our authority in Christ, and we don't have to die doing this thing. I'm going to tell you right now, there's no glory in dying in the pulpit. And I've seen some men do that, and they've not left happy people, because they were not, these men who did this were not young men. Not old men. They were still had plenty of life left in them. I'm not talking about 80, 90-year-old men. I mean, I still think that's plenty of life in you. If God says in Genesis 6 and 3, the days of man shall be 120 years, that's a minimum. That's a minimum. He said, you know, you're going to at least get 120 years. Well, there are other issues going on in life. People do what they do, live what they live. But I'm just telling you, so anybody dies before that, I still think they died young. So that's my personal theology. And so I don't think there's any glory in somebody dying in the pulpit or somebody saying, well, you know, he was 60 years old or he made his 70. That's so non-biblical. I don't even need to deal with all that. That's just Moses, not the Word of God. So anyway, the promise of God is for us to do what we do, but we do what we do in order to bless others to do. How is it that saints will grow if they don't do some work in the ministry, if they don't learn how? You know, it's one of the things that lets me know, and that's what Moses needed to know. Moses needed to know that in order for the folks around, he never saw himself. Wow, thank you, Holy Spirit. Moses never saw beyond himself in leadership. Got to get this. Moses never saw beyond himself in leadership. I'm sorry I'm not giving you numbers in my points anymore. I forgot to put numbers on them. It's important to understand, Moses was called to lead, but he didn't know how to lead either. You know, people didn't know how to follow, and Moses didn't know how to lead. But so we're all doing this as God is saying. Well, what they should have trusted, glory to God, was that God sent Moses, and Moses was the one God used to get us out of there. That's enough for me. I was stuck in Egypt. God sent Moses. I got out of Egypt. Moses, whatever God says, let's go do it. You know, I'm that kind of follower. You know, I don't know where I'm going, but I know God sent you. If you don't know where we're going, well, we all ain't going nowhere the same way, but I'm following you. If you're going in circles, I'm going in circles. But I was in Egypt. All I know is I was, you know, it's like the man said, all I know is I was blind, but now I see. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So I want to follow the man who gave me sight. Talk about Bartimaeus. That's another point. Can I tell you this? Some people think that they are following because they're crying out. Some people think that they have a great relationship with God because they're crying out. Can I tell you there's a difference between crying out to God and worshiping God? God sent Moses in Exodus 3, God sends Moses and he says, because I have surely heard the cry of my people. Verses 6 and 7, he says, now I'm going to send you to deal with Pharaoh because I've heard the cry of my people. Now watch this. God heard the cry of the people, but the people didn't have any relationship with God. They had history. Their bloodlines had history. Hallelujah. Somebody had a history with God, genetically, biologically, generationally. They had history with God, but they didn't have a relationship with God. And so, but God was attentive because he had given a word. God responded to the fact that he had given a word before most of them were ever born. And so their relationship with God was still to come. That's the thing God does with all of us. Hallelujah. He hears our cry. He responds to our cry, knowing that the cry is the beginning of relationship. Your cry to God is the beginning of relationship. So you ought to develop from the cry to the worship. You go from crying out to God, hallelujah, to praising God, hallelujah, to worshiping God. That's how your voice works. That's how you use your voice with God. You go from crying out, hallelujah, in your desperation, you know, praying, if you will, talking to God in relationship, but then praising God because of what he's done and worshiping him because of who he is. God, there's a difference. So God sent Moses in response to the cry of the people. People were under bondage. They were in desperation. So Moses obeys God. He didn't know what he was doing. He just knew God chose him. Glory to God. He didn't understand. He knew he had come from Egypt all the time being set up. He left to go back. God brings the people out. Now they're in the middle of the wilderness, and Moses is doing what he thinks is right because he has no teacher. He has no instruction manual for his leadership style. And we get to look at this because we're able to read the Word of God. We've grown enough, we've advanced enough to look at this and say, wow, you know, look at what Moses is doing. He's doing all this, but what I want you to get is Moses was doing it because he thought he was doing right for the people. People kept pulling because they were stuck in where they were, and Moses thought he was doing the right thing. So Jethro, God sends Jethro. Isn't God amazing? God knows Moses don't know what he's doing. Moses is going to die. I still need Moses to go on and get these people into the next place where they're about to cross over. He didn't get to cross over, but he needs to get them crossed over into the promised land. He says, I can't afford for him to die judging the people, doing these things. I'm judging them on issues that are, listen, the issues that will pass away. Don't get your leader caught up in issues that will pass away. You can't pay your bills. Oh my God, I'm not going to make light of this, but I'm going to tell you something. I've heard that. That's been a refrain of people all my life. All my life. You can't pay your bills. I need to pay this bill. Do you know what? That bill needs to be paid next month. That bill needs to be paid. If you got a car and you sign a contract for a car, and at 72 months, 60 months, whatever, however many months, I don't know if they do 84 months now, I don't know how many years they do now on car payments, glory to God. But you know what? Every month for the term of that contract, that bill's got to be paid. So if you can't pay it one month, you don't need to get stuck in that. You need to figure out what is God's plan. Because if your pastor has to stop and struggle with every member who's struggling with their car payment, their light bill, whatever, he's never going to be able to minister to you the Word of God. That's what Jethro's dealing with in terms of Moses. He's saying, you're dealing with stuff in the wilderness, man. You're dealing with people who are stuck in the wilderness. They're not in the land of promise. Let's wait at least till we get to the land of promise to help these people grow. You can't grow in the wilderness. Man, that's a word right there. You cannot grow in the wilderness. You cannot reach your potential in the wilderness. Moses could not get these people to maximize their potential stuck in the wilderness. He had to find a way to get them to where they were going. But because he was subject to not knowing and looked at the people around him, he felt like he had to deal with all these things. What I'm saying to leaders now, and the purpose of God doing this, is do not keep your pastor stuck where you are. Do not keep your leader stuck where you are. Glory to God. Pray. Ask God to get you unstuck. Lord, just, you know how to get unstuck? I can tell you real easy how to get unstuck. Just submit. Just submit. Just submit to the word of the person you're following. Just commit to following. Just embrace the leadership. Otherwise, you're in the wrong place. If you're not going to embrace the leadership, you're in the wrong place. I promise you this. Those people, and we see this later in the word, those people who were following Moses, they embraced his leadership style. Those who didn't, ended up in trouble, okay? I.e., you know, for those of you who know what I'm talking about, i.e. Korah. Korah, yeah, you know about Korah? Korah got in trouble because he did not embrace the leadership style. And let me tell you how Korah came about. I can tell you how Korah came about. Let me move on so I can tell you how Korah came about. Glory to God. This is getting good to me. Hallelujah. But here we are. He goes on and he's telling them, okay, he's listening to Jethro. This is all about Jethro giving him the pattern of God. It's God knowing Moses needed help. So Jethro gives him the pattern of God. And hallelujah. And so he says in verse 18, thou wilt surely wear away, both thou and this people that is with thee, for this thing is too heavy for thee. Thou art not able to perform it thyself alone. Verse 19, hearken now, listen now unto my voice. Remember, I'm reading out the King James Version, just for simplicity, just make it easy. You better get your own version, that's fine. Listen now unto my voice. I will give you counsel, and God shall be with you. Are you trying to say, wait a minute, he says, and God will be with you. Wait a minute, okay. So if God will be with me after I get counsel, so what he's really saying, okay, he's not saying God is not with you. What he's saying is God's going to agree with you. God, you're going to come in agreement. You're going to line up. You're going to come in the place where it pleases God. Are you hearing what I'm saying? He says, if you listen, hallelujah, and keep this counsel, glory to God, God, you will line up with God and get the favor of God on what you're doing, on you being the leader. Glory to God. Be thou for the people to Godward. This is big, okay? Be thou to the people Godward. For the people. Now remember, earlier he said, the thing that thou doest to the people is not good. The thing God, man, this must be getting good because I'm starting to sweat. Glory to God. Hallelujah. He says, be thou The thing that thou doest to the people is not good. Now he's telling them, now be thou for the people. You go from doing things to the people to being for the people. How powerful is that? Glory to God. He said, just make a change here because you heard them right now, but let me show you how to bless them. Glory to God. Hallelujah. He says, so be thou for the people, Godward. So here's what I like to say. He ain't got time for your issue. Now, see, people don't understand what I'm saying when I say this. You know, I used to tell people, when God moved me into an apostolic mentality of leadership, okay, that's big, okay, from Ephesians 4, from just being the bishop, I was already consecrated bishop, I've been pastoring for years, but God began to move me into an apostolic mentality. What are you saying, bishop? Well, I'm still a bishop, and I'm going to be a bishop till I die. You know, I was consecrated, so I'll be a bishop till God takes me home. But he moved me apostolically to understand I have an assignment. Glory to God. I've been given an assignment. My assignment is to get these people to the promised land. My assignment is to get them there. Whatever I got to do to get them there. So that means I cannot be stuck where they're stuck. I cannot stay because they've got stuff that won't allow them to advance. I need to tell them, look, you better talk to somebody. Yeah, you better talk to somebody. I got to go do this. Listen, talk to this sister. Talk to that brother. What do? I need to set up a form of structure so that they can have somebody who can help guide them. But keep up. Stay. Don't leave. Stay in the group. Stay in the body. But talk with this person. Because my assignment is over here, and I got to get a whole group of people there. I cannot stop for one. I can love you, minister to you, I'll pray with you, but I got to go get this done. Do you know that while I was doing that, we had a group of people. Hallelujah. We had a group of people who couldn't understand that. You know, there's always going to be somebody who feel like, well, you're my pastor. You're supposed to do this. Can I tell you? Oh, God, I can't say some of the stuff I know. I know people who pastor thousands. I'm talking about tens of thousands. I know them. You know, yes, I know them. I know people personally who pastor tens of thousands of people. And I promise you, they don't get stuck over one. Doesn't mean they don't love them. Doesn't mean they don't pray for them. And if somehow you get an appointment in all those thousands of people, you're able to get an appointment on somebody's schedule like that, they will pray with you, counsel with you, but they won't stay. That'd be your last appointment for years because there's other people out there. Are you hearing what I'm saying? What we want, we don't understand in ministries the size most of us deal with. We don't understand that we're keeping ourselves small. Well, small is good. Okay, well, small is fine if that's small for you. But some assignments, some anointings on people's lives are bigger than 20 people. Some anointings are bigger than 50 people. Some anointings are bigger than 100 people. Are you hearing what I'm saying? Glory to God. That's why God gives you opportunities for increase. He gives you connections that advance you, gives you connections that expose you. If I speak just to Revival Power Ministries, your bishop has been exposed. Pastor Barbara's been exposed. People know them all over the earth. So you cannot expect them to stay small because you don't know how to get bigger. Glory to God. Help me, Lord. I ain't trying to rebuke you. I'm trying to help grow you. You got to get a mindset to keep up. Got to get a mindset to keep up. So now if he makes the transition, watch this. I had people as I was transitioning to obeying God as an apostle, as an apostolic leader, apostolically minded leader. Hallelujah. And not denominational change, not apostolic by denomination, by assignment. Apostle of God. I was making transitions in my leadership style to keep our church growing. Hallelujah. As we keep growing, we had some people. I had a group of people that came together that said, you know, when we started, we only had a few. And now we got all these people and he don't have time for us. Well, we're not where we started. We're not what we were. And I don't know what year you started, Bishop, but whatever year that was, you're not that anymore. Glory to God. People know you. Folks who didn't know you then know you now. Glory to God. Places you had not been then, you've been now. I'm sure you weren't a bishop then. You're a bishop now. Glory to God. I promise you the anointing, apostolically minded, the apostolic assignment anointing on your life is greater, glory to God, than it was then. And so people, I don't even know how many people you have that you had from the beginning. But if they were with you from the beginning, hopefully they're keeping up or they have a desire to keep up. Because if they don't, they're going to get left. And if they're not getting left, I'm going to leave you because I'm going to say, I can't hang around with you, bishop, because you're still stuck. You're getting stuck with the people. You're getting stuck, and God has delivered you. I said this, we talk about it some more. What God said in Acts, he told Paul, he said, I've delivered you from the people who I'm sending you to. You don't serve the people, you serve God. And so Jethro says to them, glory to God, Jethro says, be for them Godward, for them Godward. That's what you got to be for them. Look, I love you, but I got to talk to God. God's got me doing this. I'm in a time of separation. Just been in a time of consecration coming into this. I don't have time for people. I don't have the time to deal with people. Listen, I'm too old for this. I'm too old to mess around with issues that men want to bring up. And I listen, I'm not throwing off. I'm just saying this is a point I need to make. At some point, you get to certain things. I've had other leaders counsel me, saying, look, man, you don't answer every Facebook message. You don't respond to every text. Because some folks have your number. They always have your number. Glory to God. Well, that's fine. I gave it out. I'm not ashamed of it. Hallelujah. But some stuff I don't respond to right away. I don't answer every call. I just don't. I'm talking to God. I'm dealing with God. I'm getting myself in a place where I can hear, where I can see, hear, and be led. Glory to God. I have a responsibility for the assignment that's given me. Your leader has a responsibility. Moses had a responsibility he did not know how to fulfill. Moses did not know how to fulfill the assignment he'd been given. So Jethro comes. He tells them, be thou, verse 19, be thou for the people to Godward, that thou mayest bring the causes unto God. This whole thing is really not yours to carry, it's God's to carry. If they want to give you prayer requests, glory to God, or if they want to give issues to other folks, then they'll bring to you. You take it all. Say, God, the people need to grow. The people need food. The people need shelter. We got to get out of the wilderness. Say that all to God, because God is the one. God is the one who chose you. God is the one who anointed you. God is the one who has taught you and prepared you for the assignment you're walking in now. Do not take a responsibility on yourself that is on God. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So he said, bring the issues to God. Bring their causes to God. Verse 20. And thou shalt teach them ordinances and laws. You know what? That's what Bishop's trying to do. Teach ordinances and laws. Hallelujah. He's teaching good word. You know, are you getting it? You know, most folks struggle to get ordinances and laws because they're still stuck in wanting Bishop to deal with their issue. Oh, man. This is better than what y'all, but I can't get it. Like, I can't hear it like I know it's being said. Glory to God. I would say something like, y'all, I'm preaching better than y'all said amen right now. Amen. Listen. God, he cannot get into the depth of the ordinances and laws that God has given him to share with you. Looks like they're going to be a little bit longer on this part. Glory to God. He can't get into it as to the point God wants to give it to you because most of us are still stuck in issues. I don't know anybody out there. I don't know who's listening to me now, so I'm not calling any names. I'm just telling you, don't be stuck in issues because you can't get where the leader is trying to get or trying to go and where God's trying to get you being stuck in an issue. I don't care what the issue is. I don't care what it is. I've been in issues. Glory to God. But you can't get stuck. I know the enemy's tried to get me stuck. Even now, he still brings issues to my life trying to get me stuck. But I don't have time. I'll refuse. I've been through too much to be stuck in stuff now. Hallelujah. And so he says, teach them ordinances, hallelujah, and laws, and thou shalt show them, verse 20, the way wherein they must walk and the work that they must do. This is, he's teaching you growth. He's trying to bring up leaders. Glory to God. Show them the way in which they must walk. My goodness. And the work that they must do. Verse 21. Moreover, thou shalt provide out of all the people able men, such as fear God, men of truth, hating covetousness, and place such over them to be rulers of thousands, rulers of hundreds, rulers of fifties, and rulers of tens. Let me stop and say this. Let me kind of wrap this up and say this. That's what I was talking about when I said there's a difference between crying out to God and worshiping God. He says this is what you got to do. Provide out of all the people. I mean, that the leader's got to spend time in prayer. Got to spend time hearing the Holy Spirit so that he knows somebody. God, give me somebody. Hallelujah. I feel it right now in my spirit. Leaders, you got to begin to cry out. Lord, give me somebody. Show me somebody. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And we talked about this, how leaders should recognize. Hallelujah. If you don't, we have to go back over it, but you can find it in the messages. If you're on any platform, you ought to be able to go back and find where we talked about it. You know, what you're looking for. God, give me somebody. Hallelujah. Who's capable, who's qualified. Leaders ought to know the folks who have a passion in their heart, desire in their heart, call of God. Committed to God, glory to God, to bless the house, bless the kingdom of God, bless people, glory to God. So what's he looking for? Provide out of all the people able men. Now, we're talking genderless now. See, this is the Old Testament, so King James Version of the Old Testament is going to say men. So he's able men, able people, I say able people of God, such as fear God. See, this is what you're looking for. People who fear God, love God. That's really loving God. Fear God, love God, men of truth, people of truth, hating covetousness. They're not stuck on other things, issues and things of people, possessions of people. Glory to God. Place such over them to be rulers of thousands, rulers of hundreds, rulers of fifties, and rulers of tens. Why? Because you got to have somebody. You got to choose somebody. Glory to God. Seemed like I didn't get very far scripturally, but I'm trying to get you to see. You know, all this comes together, and the leader, hallelujah, bishop here, you know, me and in my assignments, glory to God, whoever you are, whatever country you're listening in, whatever group of people God's given you the oversight of, you've got to have a mindset that you have people who are able, who fear God, love God, have a relationship with God. That's really what you're looking for. I always say this, they need to be people of prayer. They need to be people who would come to prayer. That you don't have to coerce people. You don't have to threaten people. You don't have to, you know, take. Well, you won't be this if you don't do that. You ought to just want to spend time with God. If the people are coming together, I don't know what this timing of this coronavirus COVID-19 thing is going to do in terms of the mindsets of people, you know, where the social distancing is in place and the restrictions are placed on the people of God. Glory to God. But it ought to give you a hunger for the presence of corporate worship. Whatever it takes, you know, if it takes some structuring of times and, you know, rotation of the people, glory to God. We just have to place a demand on worshipers and ministers, glory to God, so that people can come into the house of God. You know, whatever it takes, but you ought to be having hunger. You ought to have a hunger, glory to God. You have a hunger. It's important to have a hunger. That hunger will drive me to pray. That hunger will drive me to worship. That hunger will drive me to be a part. I want to be more a part. I don't want to be less a part. I want to be more committed, not less committed. Glory to God. Why? Because God is looking for able men. He's the people that fear God, people who are just, people who walk before God. You know, one of the biggest things about that principle is that same principle is established all the way through the apostolic leadership style. Glory to God. When the apostles were looking for people, and I'm jumping ahead, but I'll say it again as I get to that point. When the apostles were looking for leaders, they said, seek you out among you, you know, seven men full of the Holy Ghost, you know, men who love God, men who were looking for God, men who were led by the Spirit of God, men who wanted to do the most they could to maximize their lives and get the most out of the people they were sent to minister to. And so what they ended up doing was choosing people who we call deacons, or people who sit at the wait the tables. The church I grew up in called said they chose deacons out of the ministry. They chose people whose heart was already committed to God, people who were already doing things that proved where they were with God. That's what God was telling Moses. That's what Jethro was telling Moses. Look for folks who are committed, whose mindset and willingness is greater than what others are around them, who are willing to sacrifice when others don't. You know, that's leaders need that. Leaders need that. Every leader on every level needs somebody who will pray with them. Every leader on every level. And I don't believe that anybody should advance into a place of influence, a place where they are dealing with lives of people, if they're not praying. If they're not demonstrating they have a relationship with God past just coming to church, past just saying I'm a Christian, glory to God. And there are ways to demonstrate that through your commitment, your giving, your support. You know, call the pastor. Pastor, I'm praying for you. I know it's a tough time. If you don't answer, leave him a message. You know, that's even better. That the bishop doesn't answer, or pastor doesn't answer. You know, I just wanted to call. No need to return this call. I just wanted to let you know I'm praying for you. I just want you to know that I'm with you. Just want you to know that I have not gone away just because we have not been able to come to the house of God. I'm still with the ministry. I still am assigned there. God still wants me there, and I'm going to do everything I can, even in a time where I'm not able legally. You know, because of Caesar and the restrictions that the government, I call the government Caesar, because they have put on our worship, hallelujah, I'm still a part. And because of those restrictions, I may not be able to show it tangibly in my presence, but I'll show it in my support. Glory to God. I'll give my offering, my tithe, special gift. Here's just a gift, $50, $100. I'm sending this. You ought to get that in your Cash App, in the Cash App, in the Givelify, and the Tithely, whatever your form of giving is. Glory to God. You know, you ought to get that. But this for you, because I want you to know I love you. You know, I want you to know that God is for what we're doing. Don't you give up, because I still need you to get me from Pharaoh, hallelujah, into the promised land. Still need you to get me, make sure I don't get stuck in the wilderness. Glory to God. And that's what leadership is about. But leadership needs help. Leadership needs somebody who will be willing to make those sacrifices, step into the place of opportunity, and bless other people other than themselves. That's where we're at. Glory to God. Looks like we'll finish this up, glory to God, the next time, and maybe transition to David. But I want you to know, you cannot get stuck and keep the leader stuck. If you're struggling, find somebody who can help you pray. But encourage the leader to keep moving forward so that I can get out of here and move to my next level. In Jesus' name. God bless you. Glory to God.
Hallelujah.